In the last class, we learnt about linear operators and their adjoints. And I also told you that an operator which is its own adjoint is called a Hermitian operator. Let us look at one more example of calculating the adjoint of an operator. Let us see what is the adjoint of the adjoint of an operator. So suppose we do the process of adjointing twice, what do we get? So we want to calculate this. So we have the operator AB first, so I want to calculate the adjoint. How is the adjoint defined? The adjoint, in order to define the adjoint, we have to introduce two wave functions. Let us call them phi and psi. So the operator A acts on the wave function psi, and I take the inner product of that with phi. This is some complex number. I define A dagger, or the adjoint of A, to be another operator, and this operator is defined in such a way so that when A dagger acts on phi, inner product with psi, the complex conjugate, it is the same complex number. So if I give you an operator A and ask you to find its adjoint or dagger, then you have to find such an operator when it acts on phi, where A acts on psi, when A dagger acts on phi, and I take inner product with phi here, I take inner product with psi here, and then take the complex conjugate, it gives me the same number. So I have to find such an operator. And yesterday we found the adjoint for two operators, x and the derivative with respect to x. Now today we want to see what is the result of doing this operation of finding the adjoint twice. Now let us define A dagger to be another operator called B, just for to avoid confusion. A dagger is B. So this, let us look at this psi B phi. The term on the right hand side of the equation above is just the complex conjugate of this. Now let us now obtain B dagger. So B dagger will be defined so that when B acting on phi inner product with psi is given to be some complex number, then B dagger acting on psi inner product with phi should be the same complex number. B dagger is defined in such a way. So we have to find an operator which satisfies this equality. And we know that given B, if we can find the operator which satisfies this, then we know we have found B dagger.
So complex conjugate
star. So the quantity over here, this quantity, so we get the relation that psi A dagger phi star, this, the complex conjugate of this is equal to this. So is equal to, so this is equal to the complex conjugate of this, which is equal to the complex conjugate of this. And doing complex conjugate twice, it gives us back the same thing. That is, if z is a complex number, this is equal to z. So using this, we can say that this is equal to because this without the complex conjugate is equal to this. So if I put the complex conjugate,
then this complex conjugate goes away, because I have two complex conjugates of this quantity. So finally, what we obtain is that phi A psi is equal to this thing over here, which is phi, and we have B dagger, but B is equal to A dagger itself, so we have A dagger dagger psi. So we finally arrive at the conclusion that A, that doing adjoint twice gives us back the same operator. It might have been obvious to some of you, but here we have worked it out. So let us now move on to something else from, let us now look at the product of operators. So we have two operators, A and B, and we can define another operator, C, to be the product of these two. What is the significance of this? So the operator A, B, this is one operator which is the product of A, B, acting on psi is equal to A acting on, first B will act on psi, and then A will act on this whole combination, B into psi. So when we multiply two operators, the resulting operator is something, the resulting quantity is another operator, which we can call C or anything else. And the action of this product of two operators on a function is given here. So the one on the extreme right will act first, and then the one on the left will act on the whole combination. Now, there is a big difference between operators and numbers which comes about here. If I have two numbers, let us say I have two numbers, A and B, then AB is equal to BA. Numbers, ordinary numbers, commute. The product doesn't matter in which order I take the product. So they are said to commute. On the contrary, two operators, it is very important the order in which I multiply them is not equal to B, not necessarily equal to B into A. It may be equal to, in which case the operators are said to commute. But in general, this need not be true. Or in other words, the action of A on B psi need not be equal to the action of B on A psi. It may be under certain circumstances. So let me give you an example of a situation where we have two operators which don't commute. Let us look at the action of the operators x dx on psi. Dx is just the partial derivative with respect to x, and psi is a function of r, or it could be just a function of x, it doesn't matter. So this is equal to x acting on del del x of psi. D will act first on psi, which gives us the partial derivative of psi with respect to x. Now, when x, the operator x, acts on any function of x, it just gives us the argument into the function itself, which is this. Now, let us apply these two operators in the reverse order. So when x acts on psi, I get the operator x acting on psi just gives me the variable x into psi x, psi r. And when I take the partial derivative of the product of these two functions, I get two terms. The first term is the same as what I get earlier, which is x into del psi del x. But I get one more term, which is just psi. This partial derivative can act on x or on psi, which gives me two terms over here. So we find that the operation of x d, this is one operator, the product of these two, and this is another operator. So the operator which I get when I multiply x and d in this order is different from the operator which I get when I multiply x and d in the reverse order. Okay, so here we see one example of a situation where we have two operators, x and the partial derivative, or x and d, which do not commute. The order of multiplication is very important. So we define something called the commutator. Which is central, something very important in quantum mechanics. So we define the commutator of two operators. So the commutator of two operators, A comma B, is another operator which is obtained by first multiplying A and B in the order given here, so AB, and then subtracting the product in the reverse order. So this defines the commutator of two operators. It tells us how much, what is the difference I obtain if I reverse the order in which I am multiplying the operators. So let us calculate the commutator of x and dx. So we can calculate this very easily by acting with this on a function. So let us act with this on a function over here. Let us So we want to find the operator which is the commutator of these two operators, and the way we can go about doing it is to take this operator and act on a function. The operator is this quantity over here, and this acts on the function. Now we have already evaluated these two terms, that is x d acting on psi, which is given here, and dx acting on psi, which is given here. So we have to just subtract these two equations to get this. And on subtracting these two equations, what is left is just psi, minus psi. So what we have is that this is equal to minus psi. Or we can say that this commutator x d is equal to minus 1. Minus 1 or minus the identity operator. Okay. Yes. Dx. So we have defined what is the commutator of two operators. Let us go back to our thing here. So this is equal to minus 1. We can also define the anti-commutator of two operators. So let me also define the anti-commutator. Anti-commutator. So the anti-commutator is defined by curly brackets. And this, as you can guess, will be plus B A. And it, we can write the product AB to be equal to half times the commutator of AB plus the anti-commutator of AB. And we can write BA as some difference of these two. So what have we done? We have defined the product of two operators, and then we have also defined the commutator of two operators. This quantifies the fact that the order in which you multiply the operators is important, and it tells us how much is the difference if I reverse the order. This is unlike numbers. The commutator of two numbers is obviously zero, because it doesn't matter in which order I multiply them. We have also defined the anti-commutator, which is the symmetric combination of the products of two operators. Now, let us also look at the adjoint of the product of two operators. So what is the adjoint of the product of two operators? So what we want to calculate is this. We have two operators, A and B. And we want to calculate the adjoint of this. How much is this, is the question. So let us apply the whole machinery of calculating adjoint. We have looked at a few examples, and hopefully it is familiar to us already. So we have to proceed by introducing two wave functions. And we have A, B acting on psi. You can put a bracket here. So B will first act on psi, and then A. Sorry, there will be no dagger here. So we just have A, B acting on psi, the product of two operators acting on psi. And we want to calculate the adjoint of this combination. So this is just phi A acting on B psi. So B will act first on psi and then A. Let us call B psi. So B acting on psi is going to, B is an operator. When it acts on psi, it gives us another function. Let us call that function sigma. So this is nothing but phi A acting on sigma. Now we can define the complex, the adjoint of A. So the adjoint of A is defined in such a way so that this whole thing is equal to sigma A dagger acting on phi complex conjugate. Now let me also call A dagger acting on phi to be some chi. This is another function. A dagger acting on phi gives me some other wave function which I call chi. So this is equal to sigma inner product with chi star. If I interchange these two functions, then this complex conjugate will go away from the definition of the inner product. So this is equal to chi inner product sigma. If you remember the definition of the inner product in terms of the integrals, then this is very clear. Okay. So let us now put back what is chi. So chi, or let us put back what is sigma rather. So this is equal to chi B psi. And now we use the definition of the adjoint of B. So this is equal to psi B dagger, and chi is A dagger phi. A dagger phi. Now, this, look, let us look at this. This is also equal to psi A B. This is some operator, the dagger of this phi complex. This should be a complex conjugate here. So if you now equate these two are equal, because the definition of the complex the adjoint of the of this operator, the product of AB, is AB dagger, and it is defined like this. We also show that this is equal to this over here, so which allows us to identify AB dagger with B dagger into A dagger. So we find that the order of multiplication gets reversed when you take the adjoint of two operators. Now let me ask you a question. Suppose A and B are two Hermitian operators. Does it follow that the product of AB is a Hermitian operator or not? So let us look at that. Suppose AB are two Hermitian operators. Does it follow that the product of AB is a Hermitian operator? For an operator to be Hermitian, it should be equal to its own adjoint. Now, so I have the operators. So the question we are asking is AB Hermitian if AB are Hermitian? Is the product of two Hermitian operators Hermitian? Let us check this. So I have the product, the fact that A and B are Hermitian implies that A dagger is equal to A. This is what is meant by A being Hermitian. The fact that B is Hermitian means that B dagger is equal to B. If AB is Hermitian, what does it imply? It implies that AB dagger is equal to AB. Let us check this. We know that AB dagger is equal to B dagger A dagger, which is equal to BA. So if AB is Hermitian, it should satisfy the fact, should satisfy the relation that AB dagger is equal to AB. We find that AB dagger is actually, if A and B are Hermitian, AB dagger is equal to BA. So the question arises, under what condition is AB Hermitian? So AB is, the product is Hermitian if the two operators commute. If the two operators commute, then we can say that this is equal to B, or this is equal to AB. If the two operators don't commute, we cannot reverse the order of multiplication, and it is not Hermitian. So the product of two Hermitian operators is Hermitian only if the two operators commute, otherwise no. So we have looked at some properties of Hermitian operators, or some we have discussed the multiplication of operators and how to take the adjoint. Now we come to the most important property as far as this is concerned, quantum mechanics, of Hermitian operators. And let me write it down first. It's a theorem which we shall prove. And the theorem is that, okay, before getting to this theorem, let me define what are the eigenvalues and eigenfunctions of operators. So suppose I have an operator A. Let us assume that it is Hermitian, or maybe not, doesn't matter. So A in general, acting on a function psi, gives me some different function. Let us call it chi. Right? For example, if A is the partial derivative, then the partial derivative of a function is something else. Partial derivative of, say, the derivative of sine x is cos x. Right? So the operator D maps sine x to cos x. This is one example. So in general, psi and chi will be different. But there could be situations when the action of an operator is to just give back the same function psi multiplied by some number. So if for an operator like this, for some operator, if I can find such a function, these functions are called eigenfunctions. For example, for the operator D, the partial derivative with respect to x, the eigenfunction is e to the power I k x. The derivative of this with respect to x will give me I k into e to the power I k x. So the action of the operator is to just multiply the function, gives us back the same function multiplied by some number. The number could also be 1. So any such function which satisfies this relation is called the eigenfunction of the operator. And these numbers which appear here are called the eigenvalues. So if I have a function e to the power I x, this has the eigenvalue 1. Because if I take for this operator dx, the function e to the power have the eigenvalue I. The function I 2x will have the eigenvalue 2i. Okay, so for an operator, I can have different eigenfunctions with different eigenvalues. Okay, so I hope this picture is clear. Now, operators may have a discrete set of eigenvalues or a continuous set of eigenvalues. In this case, the operator has a continuous set of eigenvalues. Because k can be any number from minus infinity to plus infinity, it is still an eigenfunction, and these are all eigenvalues. In some situations, for example, if I restrict the range of x to be within some fixed range of value, 0 to a, then all functions e to the power ikx will not be allowed. The functions will have to disappear at the boundaries. So in some situations, the range of eigenvalues is discrete. The eigenvalues have discrete values. So the notation we are going to use is as follows. If A is an operator which has discrete eigenvalues, let us say eigenvalues A1, A2, AN. A is an operator with a set of discrete eigenvalues A1, A2, AN. Then the corresponding functions we shall label as follows. psi A1. So psi A1 is the eigenfunction such that when A acts on psi A1, it gives me A1 into psi A1. So psi A1 is the eigenfunction corresponding to the eigenvalue A1. Etc. So this was discrete. In a situation where we have an operator A which has continuous eigenvalues, let us say the eigenvalue A is some number which could lie in some range. So let us say minus infinity to infinity. It could be in some finite range also, but it is continuous. So this is continuous. So A is an operator which has an eigenvalue which could take any value in some range. So it has a continuous range, set of eigenvalues. Then we shall use the following notation. We shall use psi A to denote the eigenfunction. When A acts on this, it gives me A psi A, where A now could be any value. If I want to refer to two different values of this eigenvalue, then I could have another function, for example, psi A prime etc. So in this case, I cannot enumerate the eigenvalues. Here I can enumerate them, the set of eigenvalues being discrete. I can enumerate them with 1, 2, 3, 4, etc. Here, this is continuous, so I cannot enumerate them. So this is the notation that we are going to use. Now, what is the theorem which I shall be considering? The theorem which I shall be considering is as follows. Let me then move on to the theorem. So the theorem is that the eigenvalues the eigenvalues of a Hermitian operator are real. We want to use, in quantum mechanics, dynamical variables are represented by Hermitian operators, right? So it is very important, it's a very important fact, mathematical theorem, that the eigenvalues of Hermitian operators are real. After all, we want to use these operators to represent physical quantities, which always give us real values when we measure them. Okay. This is the first part of the theorem. The second part of the theorem is that the eigenfunctions corresponding to different eigenvalues are real, are orthogonal, orthogonal. So the eigenfunctions corresponding to different eigenvalues are orthogonal. So I shall explain what is meant by two functions being orthogonal when we come to it. So let us first prove the first part of the theorem. So the first part of the theorem proceeds as follows. Let us consider a situation where we have discrete eigenvalues. So in a situation where we have discrete eigenvalues, let psi A1 be an eigenfunction of the operator A with eigenvalue A1. And let A2 be another eigenfunction with eigenvalue A2. So A1 and A2 are just some numbers, right? Now let us take the inner product of this wave function A acting on psi A1 with psi A2. So let us look at this. Let me just write it down explicitly. Okay, before that, so this is now equal to psi A2. The action of operator A on this function is nothing but A1 into psi A1. Now let me write this down explicitly just to remind you of what these inner products actually are. So this is equal to minus infinity to infinity psi star A2 into A1 into psi A1. This is what this actually means. This was just the short notation. This is what it actually means. Now, this A1 is just a number which we can take outside the integral. So this is equal to A into minus infinity to infinity psi A2 star psi A1 d cube r, which is equal to A1 into psi A2 psi A1. Now, let us also calculate this. So, we now take A acting on psi A2, and this acts, this is inner product of this with psi A1. So, this is equal to psi A1 A2 psi A2, which is equal to A2 psi A1 psi A2. Now, let us take the complex conjugate of this equation. So the complex conjugate, or okay, let us take the complex conjugate of this equation. So the complex conjugate of this equation is psi A1, or no, let us not take the complex conjugate of this equation. Let us, okay, this equation we can write also as following. We can write this equation as psi A2 A dagger psi A1. The left hand side of this equation is equal to this. From the definition of A dagger, this is also equal to this. Now we know that a dagger, or okay, we know that a dagger is equal to a. So this is equal to psi a2, sorry, a acting on psi a1 star. So this is equal to a1 psi a2 psi a1 the whole thing start, because we have already evaluated what this is, psi a2 a acting on psi a1, psi a2 a acting on psi a1 is a1 into psi a2 inner product with psi a1. So the complex conjugate of this is the complex conjugate of this, which is what I am writing here. So the complex conjugate of this is the complex conjugate of this, which is equal to the complex conjugate of a1 into psi a2 psi a1 star, which is equal to a1 star psi a1 psi a2. So what do we get? We have found, starting from this, that when A acts on psi A2, it gives us the eigenvalue A2 and the inner product of this with psi A1. This can also be written in terms of the adjoint to be this. Now, if A is Hermitian, it is its own adjoint. So this is also equal to this over here, using the fact that A is Hermitian. And then, using the result which we had worked out a little earlier, we can show that this is equal to this. So this is equal to this. It is also equal to this. So subtracting these two should give us 0. So we obtain, finally reach the conclusion that A2 star minus, rather A, okay, so we reach the conclusion that A1 star minus A2, the inner product of psi A1 psi A2, is equal to 0. So let me just recapitulate what we have done. A1 and A2 are different eigenvalues of the operator A. Psi A1 and psi A2 are the corresponding eigenfunctions. And with a little bit of mathematical jugglery, we have obtained this relation. Let us analyze this relation in two situations. The first situation is when A1 is equal to A2. If A1 is equal to A2, what this gives us for A1 equal to A2, that is, if I make the two eigenvalues the same, I could make these two the same. I could choose these two functions to be the same. If I choose these two functions to be the same, then what I obtain is A1 star minus A1 inner product of psi 1 with itself is equal to 0. Now the inner product of psi 1 with itself is, let me write that down here. So this quantity over here, which is the inner product of psi 1 with itself, is being written here. So this is psi A1 star multiplied by psi A1 d cube r. Now this is the complex conjugate, some complex number multiplied by its own complex conjugate. This quantity is greater than equal to 0. So we are integrating something which is greater than equal to 0. For this quantity or for this inner product to be 0, this function has to be 0 everywhere. But then it doesn't serve our purpose. If I have a wave function which is 0 everywhere, how can I use it to describe a particle? So this is ruled out. So this integral or this inner product, and the inner product of a wave function with itself, cannot be 0. It has to be positive. So which leaves us with the only alternative, only one alternative, that is these two things exactly cancel out, which implies that A1 star is equal to A1. So we find that the eigenvalues are real, are necessarily real. So this proves the first part of the theorem, which is that the eigenvalues of a Hermitian operator are real. Let us now prove the second part of the theorem, which follows from this. Let us consider a situation when, so let me write this down in the next page. So let us consider the same equation, A1 star minus A2, the inner product of psi A1 with psi A2 has to be 0. So let us now consider a situation when A1 is not equal to A2. The two eigenvalues are different, not equal to A2. If the two eigenvalues are different, then it tells us that if two eigenvalues are different, the two wave functions also satisfy, give us this. So the inner product of two wave functions corresponding to two different eigenvalues is 0. Or if I write it in the full expanded form, I have minus infinity to infinity psi A1 star r psi A2 r. This is 0. So this is what we mean by saying that two functions are orthogonal. It is as if they were perpendicular. Their inner products, the dot inner product you can think of as some kind of a dot product. So if two vectors are orthogonal, they are perpendicular to each other. Similarly here, the inner product of these two functions is 0. So the inner product of two eigenfunctions corresponding to different eigenvalues, they are orthogonal to each other. So we have actually proven the theorem which we started out, set out to prove. Okay. So I shall stop here today. In the next class, we shall continue with a little more of mathematics and then finally, hopefully, make contact with the physics.